this shit, guys. It's crazy.
So let's start.
Should we
say something about what is how to build a fire?
Yeah, let's do that.
Because I think there are a couple of people here who haven't been before. So
How to Build a Fire
is a monthly storytelling event that was created by the man who just left the picture. Terence, whose iPhone is still here, but he is not. Terence Degnan is a poet who started this series 6 years ago. And each year he chooses a pair of hosts to bring storytellers into this space. And this year it's been me and the lovely and fabulous Christina Marks. And each month we each invite two storytellers come to the space. Usually we are not on Zoom. Usually we are actually in a physical space in the South Slope in Brooklyn. But Zoom has served us well these last couple of months.
And by the end of the season, I think we will have done as many on Zoom as we had in the space.
Right? It's crazy.
Yeah.
I hope it's not true, though, because that would mean we'd been home for like 6 months. That would be horrible.
I've got enough canned beans for the next 9 years. I would like to introduce Stacie Evans, my beautiful co-host.
Oh God, my Stacie! Incredibly depressing bio.
Yes. Before I do that though, so that we can all celebrate her a little bit, I like to introduce a little bit of Zoom etiquette. So clapping doesn't really translate. It doesn't sound great. It's kind of jarring. So like waving your hands, a bit of jazz hands, it's really nice. I love some jazz hands.
Snaps are good.
Snaps are great. And if you don't want to make a noise or you're feeling weird about waving your hands around, I'm not, did I mention drama school? down the bottom of the screen, you'll see a little button that says reactions.
Use reactions.
And you can click it. And then you can be like, clapping for you. So cute. Thumbs up. You're great. So I'll introduce Stacie and then we'll practice them because she's amazing and deserves all the applause. All of it. Sometimes Stacie would welcome forgetfulness, would give thanks for it. There are too many painful, ugly things brought to the front of her memory right now. Too many memories being created in these last few days that will be added to the list of painful things to remember. And these are the memories that don't fade, the ones for which Stacie has, in fact, total recall. But she is here at How to Build a Fire tonight, not to forget all of those things, but to remember too, that there is love and the possibility of laughter, to remember that it's okay to step away from pain, to step away from the horror show and be embraced by this warm and excellent space. And she thanks all of you for being here too, to share the space. Yay!
Thank you. I'm gonna clap for all of you silently.
Yay!
And now I am gonna introduce my fabulous co-host, Christina Marks. Christina Marks is a Brooklyn-based artist from Australia. She is a slashy actor slash director slash illustrator slash baker slash dog namer. She is loving spending time in the park and shiitake mushrooms. Everyone, Christina Marks.
Mushrooms are great. That's highlight of my week, eating those mushrooms today. This has quickly surpassed it. Let's introduce the theme of tonight, which if you had a read of the event, is total recall. If you didn't, it's still total recall. not only is it a fabulous film from the 1980s, badly remade more recently. Don't watch it. It's not good. But it means a bunch of different things to a bunch of different people. So May 1st, we wrote this for the month. May 1st marked 40 days of official lockdown in New York City. We are now, as I mentioned, at 3 months. With millions of people nearing upwards of 3 months in isolation, grief, and endless cycles of Friends reruns, there really is nobody to tell us that it was going to be this way. Nobody told us it was going to... Wow. Give me some rope. I've been on it for a long time. Left to our own crock pot of thoughts, how are our memories holding up? Already a mysterious and core part of our human experience, memory can be slippery and rigid, subjective and apparently objective. How do we use memory to process grief, make decisions, and understand ourselves? How will our memories of the past help us shape our post-pandemic selves? What is the wonder of using our knowledge of the past to fuel our imagination of what the future can be? So that's where we were kind of musing on the start of Total Recall. And we've got some marvelous folks lined up.
We do, but let's maybe give folks an idea of the run of show, as it were.
Ooh. Yeah, let's do that.
So we will have two stories, and then we'll take a short, very short break, during which you can go get a drink, go run outside and see if the moon has risen yet, whatever. But we'll have a very short break. And then we will come back and hear two more excellent stories. And then we will talk about what's going to happen in June for How to Build a Fire. So June, that far off distant land when we might actually be out in the world again, maybe, possibly.
Before we go into our stories, Shauna, I know that you're cooking dinner, but do you want to talk about anything happening at Open Source?
Yeah, I'm here. I just didn't want to be distracting. So Open Source is still moving ahead. As of right now, we are doing How to Build a Fire, obviously. We have our soup kitchen program running, which usually runs only in December, but we're doing it virtually every Tuesday night, sometimes Thursdays. So around dinner time, just get together, get on Zoom, make your dinner, eat your dinner, watch someone give a studio tour, or play music, or
whatever. Oh, that's so lovely.
It's super fun and relaxing.
What time's dinner time?
6 p.m. New York time.
Okay.
No, 7 p.m. I'm so mixed up. I'm in Denver right now, so.
Oh, backwards there.
No, I think it's 7. Yeah, and we're still doing our church. I think the next one is scheduled. Church is always the second Sunday of every month.
The Church of Monica being like a collaboration with an artist?
It's kind of an artist talk series. And usually we have bagels and coffee. Unfortunately, now you have to make your own bagels and coffee and eat in the comfort
of
your home.
I'm not going to make my own bagels.
What?
Am I making my own bagels?
Yes. Everyone?
Don't we all know how to make perfect bread now? Or
So those are still going. Things are happening with our kids program right now. We'll have more news about that next week. But all of our shows are postponed until the fall, but we have two amazing artists coming up, Duke Riley, who is absolutely incredible, and Stephanie Dinkins, who is one of my favorites. So we have that to look forward to, and there'll be more news coming out about that.
Awesome.
Thanks, Shauna.
Beautiful.
And for people who don't know, the reason that we invited Shauna to tell us about Open Source is because Open Source is where How to Build a Fire lives when we meet in person. So once we get out of quarantine, we'll be back at Open Source Gallery on the last Friday of the month to have stories. So
it's a beautiful little historic space. It's an old carriage house, and it's a tiny little space where amazing things happen and beautiful installations exist and crazy cool things like How to Build a Fire. You know, just that. It's cool.
Hey, Christina and Stacie, can I ask two questions and make two quick announcements?
Yes.
Sure.
Okay. First question is, are we recording this?
Yes.
Have we talked to the storytellers about whether or not they want to be recorded?
No.
Okay.
I'm forcing them into it.
Yeah. Well,
if you don't want to be recorded or have any stills taken of like screenshots, you can shoot us a little message with using the chat function. You can speak privately to Stacie and I, or Stacie or I. And that's totally fine. No problem at all. We'll just hit pause and not take any screenshots of yourself. But if not, we'll record it and we put the recording up on the Open Source Gallery website. So you can sift through the archives of the 6 years of How to Build a Fire and go through all of the wonderful stories that have been told in the past.
As an annotation, now they're going to be Zoom recordings, which is going to be interesting when you look at it from like a 10-year perspective. There's going to be like this moment where there's Zoom recordings. My second question, and then a couple announcements. Have you showed everybody where the bathrooms are?
Right there.
Sadly, we have not seen everyone's home, so we can't really point out the bathrooms.
All right. Now, if you can just like in the chat, drop a map to your bathroom, that would be nice.
Yeah, I'm not gonna do that.
Please practice social distancing when you're using Christina's bathroom. All right, a couple of announcements really quickly. First one has to do with Christina and Stacie. So this requires a round of applause afterwards and a thank you. But they've decided to take on this season for the rest of the quarantine, unless that happens for the next 10 years. And so
I'll do it for the next 10 years as well.
So our next two hosts are going to be in the space, unless that's a long ways away, and then we'll figure it out. But please give a round of applause to Christina and Stacie for taking on way more of a season than expected. It could be another 6 months. So.
Don't say those words out loud, Terence.
No. I
love Christina like nobody's business, but I would like to leave before another 6 months.
Not with you in other capacities. There's other facets to our personality.
Yes. The rest of us might go outside and you might be stuck in there for another 3 years. We don't know. there's been a note about Stacie. And then the other wonderful announcement is that at some point in their season, we're going to have an old school hosts event where we break up July. So in July, we're going to have former hosts from How to Build a Fire come back and tell stories. So come back in 2 months and you're going to see a bunch of former hosts come tell a story.
And come back next month, and you'll see other people tell stories. So yeah, just keep coming back. That's basically the message. Just keep coming back.
All right. Should we dive right into our first storyteller?
I think we should.
Beautiful.
Okay, so our first storyteller is the lovely and talented Amanda Fallows. So
I'm Hi, Amanda.
Amanda is a bit of a sci-fi nerd and loved the movie Total Recall and frankly wishes she had an image of that three-breasted gal as her background photo. She's deeply committed to forging connections in her space. Having lost so many people and connections in her life, she attempts to hold on to those connections through her writing and memories and by sharing stories with her family. She's also desperately anxious to make a positive mark on her corner of the world, which means calling on her ancestors, mostly by doing the opposite of what they did, and working to conduct herself such that others will remember her in a positive way. She is naturally a cranky pessimist who really doesn't care what others think until she does. So all this is very hard work for her. She is still learning how to be an adult and not to make a complete fool of herself. Everyone, Amanda Fallows.
Thank you. I am really, really nervous. I do presentations and training professionally for upwards of 500 people on a really regular basis, and they can never see me. So so this is new and awkward for me.
Well, you're lovely and wonderful.
Oh, thank you. I also, you know, this theme was announced last month at the close of last month's How to Build a Fire meeting. And I instantly got excited, partly because of the movie reference, and partly because I've had so many moments over the course of my life that came to mind when I heard the theme. And I got really excited, and I messaged Stacie about it. And then I heard or read the introduction to the theme that you ladies created, and I realized everything that's in my head has really nothing to do with that. Now Stacie has helped me understand that it's okay, and that, you know, and that I can make this whatever it needs to be. But I tell you that because it helps me to verbalize it out loud and also just to just to hope that what I have to say will resonate and not sound, you know, really ridiculous. I was super proud of this when I wrote it 3 weeks ago. And today I feel like a complete imposter. So bear with me. I'm also a crier. I'm a recently converted Christian, and I cry all the time. So I have a hanky.
Aww.
So if I have to use that, you know, bear with it. I'm going to try not to read this straight off the page because that will not be exciting for you guys, but I do have to write it down, including, you know, like hand gestures and intimate pauses. So this is going to be really awkward because I'm better on the page than I am verbally.
You're perfect.
So with that said, I've had some moments of this total recall in this idea that kind of came to mind when I first heard the theme. So many moments in my life that are just so visceral for me, memories that hit me so hard, and where I feel like an entire lifetime happens in the space between heartbeats. And that's what I'm going to try to capture. I am shaped by those moments that have happened in my life, and I continue to be shaped by them. And even weirder is I'm shaped by how I think they happened, whether or not that's actually how they happened. And some, most of my strongest moments of recall are related to music. I love music. I love to sing. I love to play instruments, and I'm terrible at all of it. I sound like broken glass. You guys remember glass packs, old muffler glass packs, that when the glass breaks and it makes this like horrible whap whap sound, that's my voice. So I won't do any of it. But music is always when I have those moments of really strong recall. And one of the moments, I want to share a few of these moments with you guys. One moment was related to my first husband. I was married when I was very young. I was 20, and that husband died. And sometimes the recall that I have about him, his name was Colin, it changes, and super confusing for me because sometimes I have these like really painful moments and other times really joyous moments. And sometimes the same thing will trigger a different experience. So, but hearing like a song or a phrase is usually what takes me back to moments in our life together. And I have these memories of sitting outside a pub, like on the boardwalk, and enjoying like drinking and people watching and sunshine. And I have this this song of mine. It's a favorite song by an old band. But I hear this song or this phrase, and here's the phrase. This is gonna sound so silly to you guys. The phrase is, someday there will be a cure for pain, and that's the day I'll throw my drugs away. And I hear that phrase and I am taken back to sometimes a very good moment and sometimes a very bad moment, but it's always encapsulated by this person who was just bigger than life for me and so incredibly large in his personality and his heart. And he was such a compassionate person, but he had a pain that was really deep. And that's what I remember. I remember feeling like I was on top of the world when I was with him. He was one of the first people, an intimate partner that showed me love and acceptance. And when I think about the pain that he had that couldn't be cured, he committed suicide. I think about, try to imagine what that feels like. And it just absolutely knocks me to my knees. And when I hear that line from that song, it's by a band called Morphine, I'm just taken back to that moment where I had it all. And then I lost it all. And that's a deep one for me. And it's just a song. I can hear the first chords of the song and it takes me back to that moment. Another moment for me is with my dad when I was a little girl. My dad suffered from substance abuse, drugs and alcohol. And he was absent for most of my childhood. And my parents were split up and I didn't see him very often. And he'd had a really traumatic childhood of his own. He grew up in orphanages in New York in the 50s and 60s when orphanages were a little different from how they are today. And he was not very emotionally healthy. And despite that, the truth is he didn't really know how to be a dad, frankly. My parents got pregnant by accident and he just wasn't really prepared to live that kind of lifestyle. But he was kind. He was a kind and loving person, and he also had a really big heart, but that kind person kind of got buried beneath drugs and alcohol. And when we would spend time together when I was a child, we were often in his garage working on motorcycles. He was, we lived in California at that time, and he was a member of the Hells Angels. And he spent a lot of time working on this or that motorcycle. I had my own tool set in the garage with my own little child-sized tools and my own workbench. He had set me up with this area where I could, you know, be out there with him. And as I got a little bit older, he would teach me how to work on engines and fix things. And so we didn't have a lot of time together because he wasn't around very much, but he, that's the kind of time we had together. So it really felt like quality time. We would have the radio on in the garage, and there were a few songs that when they came on, they required us to stop what we were doing and give ourselves to the music. And that's probably where my love of music comes from, even though we weren't really musical as a family. We did love music, and we listened to it a lot. And one of the songs in particular was called Drift Away by Dobby Gray. And my dad, like I mentioned, had a traumatic life, but he wasn't playful. He wasn't lighthearted or light-spirited. He was this reserved, stone-faced kind of stoic person. And he didn't play or roughhouse or cut loose, I guess. But there were a few songs, and that one in particular, Drift Away, when it came on the radio, he would transform into someone that was just completely different, completely free from the traumas that he experienced and free from his need, I think, to have such a strong masculine face that he showed everyone. And he would dance around the garage and he would, you know, sway to the music, and we'd sing along, and we had these moments of just really lighthearted connection. And those were so infrequent, but they stuck with me and really impacted me. My dad died about 2.5 years ago. And when that song comes up in my rotation, everything stops for me. I have to pull over. I have to cry and sing at the top of my lungs and have a moment for my dad. My dad, who was not playful or lighthearted, who didn't really know how to be that kind of person, but he was that way very occasionally. And when I have those moments, I feel such a connection to him. Remembering him, you know, singing into the wrench like it was a microphone, such a silly memory to have. But when I have that memory, when I have this moment of recall when that song comes on, and I think about my dad and the kind of mixed person he was and what he could and couldn't do with himself and his emotions, what I remember is that playful guy who would dance around the garage and sing into a fake microphone, and I feel safe and I feel loved. And even though he didn't do a whole lot to actually make me feel protected, when I think about my dad, that's what I remember. I remember that he loved me and that he made me feel safe. And infused with a feeling of security and protection. And I think my dad was probably the first one to ever make me feel that way, which I'm sure is a common narrative with dads. But there's a part of that song that says, "The world outside looks so unkind, so I'm counting on you to carry me through." I'd sing it for you, but as I mentioned, it wouldn't be good. None of us would enjoy that. When I think about my childhood with my dad, that kind of sums up how life was for us. The world was hard and painful, and even if he did it imperfectly, he carried me through it. He taught me to be stoic when life gets hard, and he taught me that life doesn't revolve around me and the things that were going to hurt my feelings, and that I would be okay. My dad straightened his life up when I got to be an adult, and he got back together with my mom, and they got married, and he got sober, and he became this kind of an informal mentor to young men who were behaving the way he used to behave when he was a young man, abusing substances and not being stable for their families. And he would help them work through how to succeed in their lives. And he did it in such a way that really connected with a lot of people. And I've had so many people tell me after he passed away, what a difference he made in their lives. He became that person that could be counted on and that could protect other people and that could share kindness and wisdom. And I don't know why I don't know why it works this way in my head, but watching him do that for other people helped unravel every childhood trauma I had related to having a drug addicted absent father. And it unraveled all the pain that I had at feeling abandoned by him for most of my life. And it was the most amazing thing to see him take mistakes he made with me and help them and use them to help other people not make those kinds of mistakes. I also have a lot less pleasant memories of my dad, but when I think about the net impact of my experiences with him, it's the good memories that hold the most power over me. And that feeling of safety I have when I think about him dancing around the garage is really more important than anything else he did, more important than, you know, the events that he missed or the lack of having his influence that I might have had. How I process information and form memories for me is often about how I feel about a situation at my core and less about what actually happened, and like I mentioned. And that's, I feel like that's a huge problem in our society, that we rely more on how we feel than what is actually happening. I think that in and of itself leads our society to trauma and a lot of pain and mistreating others. And I don't know how to feel about that. I don't know how to reconcile that in my head, but it has a kind of a funny way of playing out in my own head. I had this grandmother, my mom's mom. She was this awful person. She didn't like me when I was born. I was the child who made her a grandmother, and she was far too young to be a grandmother in her estimation. And she was not pleased that I had come into the world. And she made me call her by her first name, and she wouldn't tell anybody that I was her granddaughter. She would tell people that I was her little niece or something. And she was this really angry, unhappy, abusive, horrible woman. And I spent a lot of my childhood being traumatized by her, and not just me, everybody in my family was mistreated by her. And she played favorites with us, and she really hurt us in a lot of ways. And my mom, a few years ago, my mom wanted to go visit her, and she's getting old, my grandma, and my mom wanted to kind of see her before she died. And she didn't want to be alone with her, so she asked me to go with her. So we go and we have this visit, and towards the end of the visit, Grandma pulls out this file, this envelope from her filing cabinet. And in that file was every card or picture or letter I had ever written her. And I was completely flabbergasted from crayon scratchings from the time I was old enough to hold a crayon all through my 20s when I had decided our relationship needed to be, you know, letters and cards only. She saved every single thing I had ever given her. And she did that privately and quietly, starting from my earliest childhood. And that weird thing happened where in that moment, I felt absolutely loved by her, despite every horrible thing she'd ever done to me and to other people in my family. It unraveled all that pain. And I'm one that holds on to pain. Let me tell you guys, I hold on to it and I nurture it and I let it consume me, which is not a good thing, but it is, that is a skill that I have. And having that moment with her, realizing that she actually loved me, that's what it felt to me. I don't know if that's actually true, but that's how I felt. I felt loved in that moment. I've since come to understand that I think she was probably mentally ill, and that led to a lot of the other behaviors that she had. But again, like with my dad, I look at the net impact of that, and I choose to focus on that love. My husband's death was probably the single most devastating experience of my life. But after nearly 20 years now, what I remember, what I feel when I think about him, was that he made me feel loved. And the life I've been living since his death has brought me a tremendous amount of happiness. And that's really awkward for me to acknowledge, because to acknowledge the cause and effect relationship there, but it is undeniable that that it exists. And the awkward part is that I didn't want him to die, and I am saddened in many ways still by the fact that he is gone and that he had such devastating pain in his life. My mother-in-law once told me that no matter what I said, I should always make sure the message of love comes through. And when I reflect on my experiences, good or bad, my memory is informed on whether or not I felt loved in those moments. And I connect with others based on whether or not I feel loved or whether or not I feel like I can show them love. And I don't always do that very well. I have to work really hard to activate compassion, and I have to feel like I understand something about the person I'm dealing with in order to feel like I can love them. And I'm working on trying to just show people love no matter what. But it occurs to me that having that connection and allowing those connections to inform our behavior and our memories of events, it's healing for me. And I know that that might not resonate with everybody, and that might not really hold true for anybody else. And so I'm sorry if it sounds trite, but for me, it's absolutely true that the more I can connect with an individual and the more I can find ways to relate to them, I can love them. And I want to be the sort of person who inspires that in others. I want people to look at me and to look at my life and the way I conduct myself and remember me as somebody who can help someone else feel safe and to make them feel protected, make sure their hearts and their spirits are protected when they're with me. And like I said, I don't always know how to do it, but the desire is there, and I will keep trying until I get it right. The end.
Yay!
Amanda, that was fantastic.
I love you! Oh, wow. I don't think anybody knows how to love unconditionally. I think that's a gargantuan and like the act of a god or a spirit or a deity or an entity, something that is not human, because it's impossible to go through the transformative experiences of such deep and hollowing pain without learning some kind of distancing, but to be on a cyclical journey back into finding like where love exists, even within those experiences, is really profound. And I'm so grateful that you shared it with us.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yay,
Amanda. It's so interesting. Amanda and I met online, because we both have blogs and we both participated in this wacky project where some random guy just paired up people and said, okay, you interview that person and you interview that person and then write something about the person that you interviewed. And Amanda was the person that I got to interview. And so I got to read a lot of stuff about Colin on your blog. And that was, I mean, that wasn't all of the questions that I asked you in the interview, but I do remember asking you a lot of questions. And it's really interesting to hear this story now and realize that was 12 years ago that we met online, which is crazy. And then to see all the things that I've seen change for you in this time, and then to have all of that come together in this story. It's really amazing. Thank you.
I certainly learned a little bit about you, and now I give significantly more of a shit about how you're feeling.
I'm so glad.
Yeah. You learn about people, and then, you know, you build community. That's how it works. It's beautiful. That's a gorgeous, gorgeous sentiment.
Thank you.
Should we move on to our second beautiful story?
Go into story number two.
Yes. Story number two, Jane. Jane Townsend, give us a big wave. Hello.
Actually, Calliope Perdicaris, who I mentioned earlier, is my daughter. I'm on her computer.
So you're incognito.
Yes.
All right, I'm going to introduce you with your gorgeous bio.
My very, I don't know, time-limited bio, yes.
Jane Townsend is an actor, theatre director, part-time philosopher, casual hypochondriac, and mother with undiagnosed eccentricities and socialist tendencies. She's based in the Blue Mountains, Australia, coming to us from the other side of the world.
Wow.
So thank you for joining us on Saturday morning, is it?
Yeah, Saturday morning, 10:45 a.m.
Lovely. Well, welcome. Welcome to How to Build a Fire. Thank you for telling a story.
My pleasure. Look, I've just managed to get everybody else out of the house. And if I keep looking in the corner of the screen, it's because I'm keeping an eye on the time and, you know, the kids all start running in and it just gets a bit crazy as I, yeah, share some truth that perhaps they don't necessarily know about me. Oh, it was really lovely hearing you speak, Amanda. I feel quite nervous about kicking this off. I'm over in the other side of the world as well. I don't really know anyone except Steenie, Christina, who I've called Steenie since she was a little baby. And I met her the day that she was born. Well, later that night, anyway. and so I'm Christina's found auntie, not an auntie by blood, but an auntie by divine intervention. So, yeah, I'm feeling a little bit nervous and, you know, having moments of imposter thoughts coming in, you know, about whether I should be here telling a story to people over the other side of the world on a Saturday morning in my little house. But here I am. So, hello, everybody. So, again, I was thinking about the idea of total recall, again, you know, what did that mean? And again, I went through all sorts of different ideas about what total recall is and what it means to me. And what I kind of came up with primarily was the idea of memory again, and how we often have different memories to other people who were involved in a particular experience. So I will be colored by my age, by my feelings, by my experiences. And someone else who was in the same experience will have a very different memory to that experience than I do. And so the narrative creates the memory, or does the memory create the narrative? And how much does the memory change as the narrative changes, as you retell about the memory? Or does it stay the same and just get cemented? And as I was thinking about that more and more, I was thinking more and more about how different it is with intergenerational memory. So my memory of something, my recall of something that I experienced with my mother will be very different to the way that she recalls that memory because of what has colored her life up to that point. And you know, in when I, you know, we're sitting down over dinner and recalling a memory together as a family, and we'd sort of like have a very different emotional response to that memory, or even a different narrative about how that memory occurred and what happened in the memory. So I was thinking about that a lot, about how, especially since I'm in isolation, Australia is getting less and less in isolation. We're actually scarily coming out into the world a little bit more, and you know, restaurants are opening and bars are opening and people are congregating in big groups, and it's starting to get a little bit scary. But and I was thinking about situations that are coming up with my 15-year-old daughter, and how I was thinking about how she is going to see interactions between her and I, or you know, the conflicts that are rearing their heads during this time, how she's going to see it in the future is going to be really different to how I will see it. You know, how she perceives the way that she's being treated, or you know, controlled or spoken to, or not being allowed to have any freedom. She's going to see it very differently to the way that I see it. So anyway, that sort of sent me back into thinking about my own mother. So I thought I'd tell a couple of little stories about my relationship with my mother, and then look at how my relationship with my own daughter and how those memories are formed. So I grew up in Canberra, which is the capital of Australia. Everybody probably knows that, but it is where all the politicians hang out. They don't necessarily live there anymore. They used to, but now they all live you know, in Sydney, and they've got, you know, elaborate houses and just use a lot of taxpayers' money to fly to Canberra every time they have to meet and then fly home again every night. So Canberra was designed by Walter Burley Griffin, who was an American architect, and he won a competition in 1912 to design the capital of Australia. He's also known for designing, inventing carports. So that gives you a bit of an idea of, you know, the breadth of his accomplishments, Canberra and carports.
There's lots of carports in Canberra too.
And there's also a lot of roundabouts. I don't know if anyone's ever been to Canberra. You go round and round and you're not quite sure how to get off. But there's a lot of really nice buildings as you go around. And I think that's how we made it. So as you go around these roundabouts, there's a whole lot of beautiful things to see. So you kind of get stuck on them for a while until somebody lets go on the horn. So I grew up in Canberra, but my parents came from Bendigo, which was one of the first gold mining towns in Australia. It's one of the oldest gold mining towns. It's in the state of Victoria. And both of my parents' families lost their farms during the Great Depression, so in the 1930s. And so both families had moved into town. Now, my mother's family were very, very poor. And so my pop, Dick Walsh was my pop's name. He was a shearer. And so he would travel around Australia. Shearing, he was a gun shearer, and he was pretty good at what he did. And also he worked on the railways. So he would follow the railways up as they were being made all the way up to the Northern Territory, right at the very top of Australia. So so he was missing for years and years and years. And my gran, Rosie Walsh, would carry the family on her own. Like my mother is 18 years younger than her sister and 16 years younger than her brother, because my grandfather, my pop, was missing for many, many years, and he came back. Everyone thought he was gone for good. He came back and wanted to reinsert himself into the family and in his sort of role as father slash husband. And my mother was then born after his return. And she was told many, many, many times that she was unwanted, and she was sort of reminded that she was, you know, not part of the real family. And that sort of coloured, we're going back to colouring her memory, so that coloured who she was and how she saw the world from then on. So she was determined that she would create a different world for her children and her family. So she found my father in Bendigo, and they all moved to Canberra. My brother was one and I was born a couple of years later. Now, when my mother was growing up, she was given nothing. So she didn't really have anything. She didn't have very, like, toys, and she probably had one doll her entire childhood. And she didn't have, you know, pencils that other people had. She didn't have books. She didn't have a lot of things. And so when my parents were in Canberra and they were middle class, built their way up through the rag trade to be in through, they worked for a knitwear company in there. Boomed in the 70s. So they moved up to middle class. And when I was young, I remember a story, and this is the memory that that came to mind when I was thinking about Total Recall. So my mother controlled every moment of my life very tightly so that she could keep the dog, you know, the wolves from the door. So our lives were controlled and compartmented. And I remember one day when my mother presented me with a box of coloured pencils that were all the colours that you could possibly think of. In a box of pencils, and it was quite ceremonial. And so she gave me these coloured pencils and sort of presented them with me, and then for the next couple of weeks I proceeded to use those coloured pencils for everything other than colouring in. So I would make things with them, and I would, you know, use them to make use a couple of hankies and make a tent for dolls, or I'd go outside and use them in the garden, or I used them to make a kite, or, you know, I would do other things with them, and proceeded to lose the majority of the pencils over that time. And I remember my mother being absolutely mortified that this really important symbolic box of pencils had been used in such a frivolous way, she saw it. And so when we look back at that memory, I see it as a moment where I disappointed my mother, and I didn't know why, because I really enjoyed those pencils. I didn't enjoy them when I was trying to do a colouring in. I couldn't find green, and I remembered that it was somewhere in the backyard, but I wasn't quite sure when, where I got it.
Yeah.
She was absolutely mortified, and you know, would still bring it up as this moment where did she spoil me? Was I selfish? You know, it came with a whole lot of judgment to me, and now as an adult, I can look back at that moment and go, okay, so I had a very safe, albeit very controlled and compartmentalized childhood, but I was very safe, so I felt like I could be how and who I was. But she was very traumatized by her upbringing, that she took that into that small moment. So there was other moments like that where my mother also plaited my hair as a child, right up to when I was 14, in very, very tight plaits, incredibly tight plaits. And I was not allowed to undo my hair. So at school, I'd be petrified, like the girls would want to play with your hair because it came all the way down to my bottom. And I'd be like petrified, you can't touch my hair, can't touch my hair, because I'll be in so much trouble if you touch my hair. And then finally, when I was 14, I kind of begged for a haircut. And so my mother acquiesced after a long time of me pressuring her to get my haircut. And she, so there's this picture of me with the long straight hair and then the 1980s sort of bob with a big flick, you know, it's like, yay. And again, with the memory of that, getting my hair cut, my mother sees it as a very sad day. It's a really sad day that I cut my hair. And I see it as a moment of, you know, freedom, separation from my mother. So again, we look back at those moments and have those memories, and she was like, oh, you had such beautiful hair. It's like, I still had beautiful hair. It was just really short and in a bob. But I can see now, as a mother, I can see how my, moments that I have with my 15-year-old daughter, I can see how they will be very different in her creation of that as a memory and very different in my creation as a memory. I've written myself a few notes. So my mother also created, so she got rid of religion in her life, because she was very frustrated, and she had enough of what she saw as the hypocrisies in organized religion. My gran, Rosie, would change religions every few years. So whoever she thought she was going to get the most bang for a buck. So she was Presbyterian for a while, and then she was Protestant, and then she was Catholic. I think when she died, she went back to Catholicism again, because I think that sounded the safer bet at the end. my mother grew up kind of thinking, you know, this religion malarkey, I don't quite get it. So she had created a series of rules in our family that were not religion, but they were just rules that had to be obeyed, the rules of her. And unfortunately, one thing she did, so she threw out ceremony and, you know, all the beautiful things that can come with religion, and she threw out spirituality, she threw out ceremony, she threw out that sense of community, and, you know, we didn't have a wider community that we belonged to. But what she did keep was guilt. And so she would use guilt as a tool to control us, you know, it's like if we disobeyed. But there was no absolution. Like, you couldn't go, I'm really sorry I broke the vase. It's all right, darling. You know, there was just guilt. You know, you couldn't say, you know, I'll be better tomorrow.
Skip down on that mission.
That's right. It was a series of, and I understand now as an adult that she had to have those to survive. She created a world where she was completely in control. And it's interesting observing her now at 77, that she's very frightened to die, because she can't control that. And I try and talk to her about, you know, letting go of, you know, and having, just having faith that it will all unfold. Like, I sort of found spirituality throughout my life without necessarily an organized religion, but I sort of was constantly searching for a belonging to some sort of spiritual idea. And she's very frightened, and she's constantly going to the doctor at this moment in time, having, you know, phone consultations with the doctors about different things that are going on. So she's sort of, whereas I try to just be a casual hypochondriac, she is sort of taking it on a full-time job at the moment. I understand now as an adult why she created that world, but it just made it very very challenging. And I look back now at the memories. And the thing is about the memories as well, I'm trying to be a little bit more open to adjusting that narrative around those memories. But my mother is steadfast that her memory of what happened is what happened. But, you know, that's her scorpionic prerogative. Yes. I was also going to talk about, then I had an observation as I got older when I didn't have my children till I was 30, my first child till I was 36. Something was keeping me from going there for some reason. I observed my friends' children over their 20s and 30s, and I was kind of creating a playbook for how I was going to do this part of my life. Like, okay, yeah, that works. Oh, I like that one. Put that in. Yep, I'm going to do that. We're going to do that. I'm going to be like this. This is how I'm going to do it. And of course, none of those things were able to be implemented when my children actually arrived. Now, I heard this fantastic theory, which I really love, and I've only heard it recently, about how our brain is like a cassette player. How old this person was who told me the story. that you put, whatever tape you put in your brain, that's what the cassette player is going to play. So if you put heavy metal in, the player is going to play heavy metal. If you put opera in, it's going to play opera. So the same sort of thing, whatever narrative you put into your brain, that's what your body and your brain will believe. I mean, we know it in other ways, talking about, self-talk, negative self-talk, changing that to positive self-talk, all of that sort of thing. But I really like the symbolism. I really like the visual of putting a tape into your brain cassette. And I feel like that's what I did when I was watching all of these mothers. I was like, this is what I'm going to do. I'm not going to do what my mother did. I'm going to do this, do that. And then I started thinking about that analogy about the tape player and how, remember when we put tapes in a tape player and the tapes would get stuck and you couldn't actually get the tape out, even though you didn't want to listen to the Bangles or, listen to Pink Floyd for 7 days, and you just said, oh, I had enough, I want to take that out. And it was stuck. And you knew that if you ripped that tape out, you were going to destroy that tape because it was stuck to the tape player. So we'd go through all these processes of cutting the tape and undoing it and then rearranging it. And I'd get the sellotape out, sticky tape, and stick them back together. But it was never the same after you'd ripped it out of the... So you had to either turf it, or throw it out, or go back to the friend who had the record and retape it. So I was thinking about how that worked with my idea of how I was going to mother. I should have had an idea when I was pregnant with my daughter Calliope. I had a dream that I'd given birth to a baby and I'd breastfed her and I'd put her in a cot and I went for a walk along the beach with my mother, and I didn't know what gender the child was going to be at that stage. And I went for a walk along the beach in my dream, and then I said, oh goodness, Mum, I've got to go back and feed the baby. So I went back into the room and there was no longer a baby in the cot, and there was all these kids running around the room. And one of them was a 7-year-old girl with long black hair, and I said, oh, are you my baby? And she said, yeah, I'm not a baby. I'm 7. And I said, no, you're a baby. You've got to get back in the cot. And she's like, no, I'm not a baby. And I'm 7 years old. And I kind of was given the heads up when she was in utero that she was never going to do exactly what I wanted her to do and how I wanted her to do it, or how I perceived this process of motherhood was going to unfold. When she was almost 2, she decided to wean herself because her friend Anna had a bottle and she wanted one. And I was like, no, we're not doing that. We're breastfeeding. Come on, this is what we're doing. And she, at 23 months, 22 months, she refused to go on the breast anymore, decided that that was the end of breastfeeding. So now I have a 15-year-old daughter who wants freedom and autonomy from me. And again, I've got this tape in my head of how the letting go of my teenage daughter is going to unfold. You know, it's going to be beautiful and it's going to be so symbolic. And we're going to have shared experiences about, you know, what it is to be a young woman. And we're going to gently snip at the umbilical cord, the sort of figurative umbilical cord, and we'll both use lots of healing balms and it will be a beautiful experience. But my daughter is taking to the umbilical cord with a blunt hacksaw. And she's basically gnawing at it as fast as she can to get it off. And at the same time, I'm trying to stitch it back up again and you know, keep her and I calm. But it's not working that way. And so the narrative of this moment in our collective experience is very, very different again. And I'm thinking back to, you know, when she's an adult, how will she look at this memory and how will she see the moment of, you know, her moving into young adulthood and me moving into crone stage as her old mother. I think that's all I wanted to say. I was just kind of going back to the idea of the memories being very subjective. And memories being the other thing that I wanted to talk about very briefly was the fact that she has a cultural memory that I don't have because her father is Greek and I'm what I call an Anglo-Mongrel, Irish, Welsh, English stock. And my daughter is Greek and Russian heritage from her father's side. And I think that she has a cultural memory that is hidden deep inside her that I can't, I don't know how to connect with at this stage. So that she can connect with her father with that. And I think that's part of her fiery personality. And in very, very, in all sorts of different ways, she tries to let me know about what that is and how that feels for her. So that's another part of how her narrative is coloured as she remembers and recalls who she is. Okay, thank you.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Yay!
Thank you, Jane.
A story of the maid, the mother, and the crone, and the cycles of generations.
Seriously.
And how to access the person that you want to be from the person that you remember being in reaction.
Yes. Oh, I had so many ideas of how I was going to do this story. And then when I ran through it myself last night after a gin and tonic, I went, 40 minutes. So, red pen like that. And so that's why I'm kind of going, okay, well, that's for the, you know, that's for the one woman Zoom, you know, in future time. But
invite me to the one woman Zoom because I want the full narrative.
Yes.
Thank you for sharing that.
Thank you so much, Jane.
My pleasure.
On that note of gin and tonics, water in, water out. Let's have a 5-minute break. A soft yes. 5, hard 10. All right. So thank you. We'll be back.
There's a long line outside of your door from people that are just here to use the bathroom.
Oh, wonderful. We actually bought a bidet, so it's really fun in there. speaking of, I'm going to fill up and I'll see you momentarily.
Yes, I could be filling up as well. I will be, well, with apple juice. It's kind of boring, but still.
Just back. Should I put some music on? Try and put some tunes.
Oh, that's a good idea. Yeah.
I'll get some music happening. I think we had a call for Prince earlier, didn't we?
Yes.
Okay.
Do that.
Yes,
let's careful. Do that. Stacey's hair is going to freak out.
It'll be beautiful.
Oh, it's lightning now.
Do we have lightning out there?
Yeah, it's lightning here in Brooklyn.
I'm going. It's my little speakers going through all of the different devices that it connects to.
I was wondering, like, who's talking right now?
It's like a list of 47 different iPhones and iPads and desktops and laptops and like all of the phones.
Alberto's iPad.
connected to Terence's iPhone.
Connected to Princess's ghost.
Prince!
I definitely vote for Prince. It is never the wrong time to listen to Prince.
I know!
That has to be Purple Rain.
Well, I was going to say, let's hear a little Starfish and Coffee.
I'm going to start with neither of those because I'm in charge.
I read a whole, in coronavirus quarantine time, you have all the time in the world to read like the narrative of things.
Yes.
I read the whole narrative. It was like a 4-page thing about how Kiss was written as like this great orchestration with a funk band. and Prince like stole back the song from this huge funk band that he wrote, like he co-wrote the song Kiss with. And then he just like rewrote all the parts himself and then released it as a single.
That sounds about right.
I know. I want to hear the other version of that. I want to hear the funk version of Kiss.
I would like to hear that too, actually. Okay, I'm off to refill my drink. I will return.
They said they're going to do a whole like re-release of the album Nebraska. Do you guys know Bruce Springsteen's Nebraska? Man, everybody's going. Oh, everybody left.
All we had was good. Why don't you still call me?
No, I'm on now.
Anymore.
Key of D flat. Who does it like that?
Look at this. Look at all the pictures.
Yeah, Freddie is the king of that. You should see.
What are we listening to?
A hell of a Prince B-side.
Because he went down to the bodega to replenish our supply. And can you guys see us? We're like so in the dark here.
In the dark.
Yes.
We can see the idea of you, Terence.
Yeah, well, that's better.
Great idea.
The idea of Terence is my next book title. they say that taking off your mask at the end of the day is the new taking off your bra.
Nah, because I still have to take off my bra, so it's got to be the new something else.
Well, it's the new, Stacie, it's the new version of that. I mean, there's still the old taking off the bra. I just do at the end of the month.
So many questions.
But now it's like the new, and I, as a delivery driver, I experienced that, like, that first breath after taking off your mask feels like fresh oxygen.
That's true. Even when I haven't worn it for very long, it feels like that.
Also, this is a confession. Andrew admitted to the fact that he's now writing a narrative about the people that live across the street.
Oh yeah, I invented a whole life in my head.
We don't know the people across the street, but he's inventing
it. They look happy. My head,
Christina, your mom is here.
Her, but she ran away.
Oh, is she?
I just let her in.
Excellent.
Who's here?
Christina's mom.
There's my mom.
Hello.
Hi, Mary.
And Jen, my auntie. Hi, Mom.
Hello, darling.
Hi.
I'm Stacie. And drop the link to the event. So if you guys can wait for 5 minutes, maybe some people will join us.
Yeah, we can wait for 5 minutes. Oh my God.
We can wait for 5 minutes because I'm eating a popsicle, so we need to wait at least a couple of minutes.
Also,
we
have
bring enough for everyone?
Yeah, did you bring enough for everyone?
If only you were in my kitchen right now.
What did I bring you? I brought you dumplings.
I am in your kitchen right now.
It's okay.
Everybody on this in this Zoom room needs to know that Christina, not only is she a lovely person and an excellent cook, She is super generous with the goodies that she creates. She is always calling me up or texting me and saying, we can come over in a half an hour with dumplings. We can come over with cookies. It's amazing.
It's physically impossible to cook for two people.
I gotta
listen.
You love stories.
You can't hear it, but the dancing is great.
It's wonderful. Christina and Andrew are the primary human contact that I've had in the last 3 months. It's from 6 feet or 8 feet away, but at least there's a person in front of me interacting with me.
It's like the friendliest ransom exchange of all time.
Anyone here?
It's true.
I hear the idea, Prince.
Okay. Is it maybe not working as well as I want it to work?
Zoom doesn't like multiple sources of sound.
No, it's fun.
Why can't they? Where does the Zoom like host DJ mixer?
Yeah, there needs to be a player.
Did you do the share audio thing, Christina?
Yeah, why is that not a thing?
Share yeah, screen. I mean, like it's in House Party, right?
No, I mean, but you can do it on here. If you go into share, it gives you the option to share your audio.
Really?
Share screen?
Tricky.
Could I share my screen and put YouTube on?
We have to do the audio
specifically. Yes, you could.
Would that work how I want it to work?
Yeah, and then everybody else could just mute themselves.
I don't know. What are you going to show us? That's the question.
Well, but see, that's where you need the mixer.
What are you talking and music?
What are you saying? What are you saying about our commentary?
I think you know what I'm saying.
You're like the old Muppets.
I do know what you're saying. I just want you to say it. I want you to admit that we are drab.
I said you like the old Muppets in the box, but you're not as funny.
I have never described Hunter as drab.
I'm not scared of
really not eating my popsicle fast enough.
Damn it.
Don't eat it too fast, you'll get a brain freeze.
I know, that's what I'm trying to avoid. But now it's melting in my hand.
I feel like conversation on Zoom, at halftime, if we're live, in person, I feel like there's more swearing and more terrible, bad, dirty jokes. And on Zoom, it's I'm eating my popsicle.
Yeah, that's a dirty joke. I mean, we know what Stacie is saying.
That she's got a killer popsicle right there. And it looks.
God, stop it, Stacie. That's disgusting. That is disgusting. God.
There could be children.
Popsicle
time. Yeah, well, you don't know. There could be kids.
The best
kids in my background, but they're pretty dirty.
What flavor is that popsicle?
Yeah, what flavor? Strawberry.
Stacie, you don't have to say that. You don't have to tell anybody.
No one deserves an explanation from you.
That's true.
What flavor popsicles? Tell me. That's
feed into every stereotype about Black people. I have grape popsicles and I have watermelon popsicles. And I am not sad about it because they are the best ones to have.
Yeah, they're the best flavors.
There's only one of the popsicles I could have, but I don't think they'll work really well. So.
You what?
So there's only one other flavor popsicle she could have to truly fit a stereotype, but I don't think it would work very well.
Thinking of Prince, everybody's got a different favorite Prince song, and I want to know what yours is, what everybody's.
There's too many excellent Prince songs to have one favorite. Terence proved this about Tom Waits the other day. He's like, oh, your top five Tom Waits songs. I think I posted 20 songs.
Yeah, really?
I couldn't stop.
I hate the concept of having to pick a favorite of anything. Because if it's worth its salt, and
working. Check.
It's working. One incomparable ephemeral thing to another.
Such greatness.
It's true.
The spark rolling.
The beautiful ones. I think I have some beautiful ones. If I had to pick one.
That's a good one.
Donna.
How's your pad thai? We've seen it from Woe to Go.
It looks great.
But I felt your joy. And that's what really
That was
best part of the thing so far. She just turned off
now,
her
Monica
camera.
Was here for a second, but she seems to not be here now.
Terence, you said that, so we're getting to the point of the break where it's time to start again.
Yes, it is.
Fine. I'll mute myself.
What?
He's muting himself.
Oh,
and we lost Monica. We had Monica for the second half of Jane's story, but then we lost her, I guess, at the break.
It's Terence, like the one time I ask you a direct question, muted. Every other time, just like.
Oh, go ahead. I'm here. What was the question?
Who are we waiting for and where are they, damn it?
Our friend Justin wanted to come. Matt B wanted to come. And then I tried to get Monica in here and she was here for a second. And I guess she's probably also eating a popsicle and didn't want everybody to see that.
Beautiful.
I'm just hoping that the popsicle dyed my lips purple. That's all. I just, you know. Like when you were a kid and the popsicles always stained your face.
Stacie, if you catch my drift, I only want to see you dancing in the purple rain.
Thank you, Terence.
Purple rain. I'm going to work on a banjo cover of Purple Rain.
Oh my God.
Oh wow.
I think that's what the world is missing.
I don't even know what to do with
that. Bluegrass Purple Rain.
Playing Purple Rain.
Dueling banjos.
I mean, you wouldn't be wrong. The world is currently missing that.
It is missing it, desperately grieving the lack of me on banjo.
I would have used the word literally more than desperately, but.
Thank you.
Those are true.
But you could, you know, put something
I'm here for it, Christina. Do what you gotta do.
My only true supporter, Stacie. I really appreciate it. All these pretenders out here not supporting my Prince banjo cover band.
So I think we're not gonna add these mystery people that we were waiting for. So I think we should
move
to part two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Welcome back. Part two.
How to build a fire. Total recall. Woo.
Wonderful. Hi. So let's go straight in. Freddie, you're blocking yourself off. Da da da. In case you have not clocked onto Freddie yet, give us a wave. Freddie Yuddin. He's our third storyteller, and I'm going to read your bio so that we can learn a little bit about you. Freddie taught for 30 years in the Seattle public schools. His two children, Celia, who is now 34, and Josh, who is now 28, both of whom are very gorgeous and who I know for a fact Freddie is extremely proud of, were educated in public schools. No private schools, thank you. I forever have been interested in the arts, history, politics, language, both in the written and spoken word. Having a great conversation seems to be primary for me, a stock in trade. Travel is an addiction, and a great barista's can be found a block away. I had to find Missoula before I found Seattle, and when I first came here, it was a great place to discover. I didn't realize then how outside most time zones it is. And finally, for this round, I wish I had visited Africa more. So there's a lot about Freddie right there. We first met because I was one of those baristas that he would come in and chew my ear off in the best way. The highlight of my day was making Freddie's mocha because I got all of the gossip of the world and philosophy and art and history over the mocha. It was a good time. So. Welcome, Freddie. Oh. Yeah.
Okay. I get to see you when
Hey, Freddie.
Hey. Merks, I want to know something. When I do this, I'm looking at me.
Oh, okay. So, do you want to see everybody? Look at
anybody but me.
If you go to the top of your screen on the right, you have the ability to click on that little grid, and it'll take you back to the gallery view. There's like a little box with tiny boxes.
You got it?
Good.
Less you, more us.
Yeah, I'll just block this out. Well, first of all, I would have put something in the chat, but I'm kind of a Luddite with this. And Amanda, I just want to thank you for to be vulnerable, to actually show your vulnerability about the past in front of people that you don't know. That's brave. I mean, and it was just actually great hearing the whole, it was huge. And, thanks. Because to show that much sensitivity about your life and the part of your life that it was, it's so critical. I'm just sitting in a chair over here in Seattle and I'm hearing an incredible story of a person's life that I didn't know you an hour and a half ago. So thanks. And the Australian, that one, I mean, it's like, I know many Aussies, Mercs, of course, and I think Seattle's out of a time zone, but having never visited Australia and knowing a few people who actually live there, not just, the two of you who I'm looking at right now, and I think there must be a third one as well somewhere. Oh. I just can't, okay, four. When you say Canberra, Sydney, and the Blue Mountains, was that it? Are you kidding me? It's like, people are interested in science fiction and all this. This is where you're talking from? It just knocks me out. I mean, it's part of the earth, but I haven't been there. And people come from there and they live there. The world's just great. And it's like this funny gravity. It's just, anyway. Anyway, so I'll get into my story because we'll see how long it is. Because I was going to do one and it had too many gaps to it. So I'm doing one that has no gaps, really. And I, of course, the great, when you're thinking in the tub or something or in a shower, oh my God, the story is, it's there. Today or yesterday or for the last 3 days has been this festival of Shavuot in the Jewish tradition. And in, it's funny because Shavuot, naming it with a T or having it with the T in the end is the Hebraic way of saying it. Because when I was growing up, it was Shavuos. But it's great because it was the giving, this is hard to believe, it was the giving to Moses by God of the Torah, which is almost impossible to actually think it was actually true, because Wikipedia says he was given the Torah in 49 days of being in Sinai, which of course is really the first five books. The first five books of the Torah, it took 40 years at least, because it ends with Moses not being able to go to the promised land. So that took about 40 years. And so Wikipedia says 49 days. I mean, really, you have to be kidding. But so if you believe it literally, blah, 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 but this story starts with Shavuot because it was 8 years ago when my son was a 10th grader and he was in this confirmation class at this very progressive reform synagogue that I've belonged to since 1990. What was that?
Let's mute yourself.
Me?
Sorry. Oh. No, that's us.
It was the dulcet tones of Brooklyn.
Thank you. Anyway, my son didn't want to go to the confirmation. I don't know how he got there to be with his classmates, good friends from all, different schools in the city. And the person who was supposed to read from the Torah itself didn't want to read. I mean, it's amazing. The guy just didn't want to read. But the reason I'm actually saying this is that the father of one of Josh's friends, whose name was Matthew, he cut out in the middle, and I was wondering why is he, he was a big guy, he had a bronze face, he was probably the most physically fit guy I've ever known. I mean, you wanted just to touch him. And in Green Lake, that Christina knows about, this great, wonderful artificial lake that is one of the greatest walking palaces in the city of Seattle, I'd always see him in the in the place where the real athletes would pull up on the rings. And I would grab onto them, it would be like a fool looking at the rings, but he would lift himself up. And so every now and then walking Green Lake, Alex's dad, Matthew, would just be showing off. He wouldn't be showing off how beautiful he was, but the guy was, you know, you talk about abs. I have zero, and this guy had, he kept working at it and working at it. And I used to see him come out of the Seattle Athletic Club sometimes too, again, working out. I don't work out. He worked out totally. And he was just this bronze god. There was no doubt about it. So he snuck out, and I asked him after the service, what were you doing? And he, you know, the playoffs, the NBA playoffs are going on. And he went out to find out how the Lakers were doing. And I said, in his own kid's confirmation, the guy was so addicted to sports, he had to just leave. So he came back. The problem with this, and this is why it connects in some, you know, real way to what Amanda was talking about, was this guy was beautiful. He was married to a beautiful wife. The kids that both Matthew had, you were two gorgeous kids. But he was beautiful, of course, to see. It was his great facade because he was just wrecked by a depression that finally did him in. Because one day, about 4 years after the time I'm talking about, he just rode into the mountains or went to some mountains and disappeared. And that was the end of him, you know, physically, I guess. But his son has always been a great, you know, it's just been a fantastic friend to my son. And I'd always take them on Tuesday nights to Tuesday night religious school. And he would hardly say a word. And his son also, Alex is just, you know, just he's about 6'2", 6'3". He's just great looking. It was just great. But he would be so quiet. And I'm a person who talks too much. And so I misread quiet people. Because they're not talking. And it's not like they're, of course, not thinking. They're just not talking. And I talk. I don't talk in my sleep, but I talk. And anyway, so, but I always liked the relationship that Josh had with Alex. And so this actually, you know, years ahead, actually just last November, he's been living in Paris with his French girlfriend. And his French girlfriend is a banker. And she's, as he says, you know, Freddie, she makes a lot of money. I said, good, I guess. She's working in a bank, blah, you know. He met her in Bordeaux. She's from Toulouse in the south of France. And so twice during my visit there in November, we had we spent an afternoon together. And I've always felt really close to him. You know, not just because Josh is such good friends with him and they've lived together actually in New York, actually they lived in Brooklyn, somewhere between Crown Heights and Bed-Stuy for a while. Anyway, so we met for lunch. This is, I don't know. I think I could tell you this is on the 14th of November or something. And we met at one of his favorite ramen places. And he comes with his long grayish black coat. And he always wears long coats. And he had a New York Yankees cap on. And I said, you don't like the Yankees. I know he doesn't like the Yankees. But he just wanted to know to every Parisian that he was, yeah, he's from another place. And his French is great. And so we're sitting there jammed in this ramen place. And it was about 8 minutes from where I was staying. It was in the sixth arrondissement in Paris. And I got there early because I get nervous. I didn't have, you know, one of these stickums in the phone. What do they call them in Europe? And, you know, so you could always be online, but I didn't have it. So I had to meet him at a certain place. And so we met. The ramen was really great. And what had happened earlier in the day was I was walking down a street called Rue de Odéon, and I was looking at these rare bookstores. I mean, they have bookstores that are so spectacular for a bookie like myself. I mean, they were incredible. And, you know, they have manuscripts and books in these stores that are five, you know, $5,000, $10,000, $15,000, $20,000, $25,000. Not quite what I want to pay for even a rare book manuscript. So what happens after lunch? Well, what happened was in the morning, I went by two stores. One was called Benoit Forgiot's, and I met him at the Armory Show in New York in March. They have this great antiquarian bookseller, you know, on the weekend, like the first full weekend in March. And so I met him the previous, last March, and then I went to his store because I wanted to know if he still had one of these, this compilation of photographs by this Russian woman who made puppets in the 1920s, Maria Vasilyev. And it, the price of the photographs was something like $9,000. But Benoit Forgiot showed me this. He was so glad that I was interested in the books that he just displayed them, and I didn't get them, but I really appreciated, you know, his artistry and actually just showing me the books. So I stopped by his store. It wasn't open because it was before noon. And then I went by another store about three shops down. And this is another rare bookstore. And it had this huge collection of Haim Soutine. It was a book on Haim Soutine, one of my son's favorite artists. And I didn't really know what was inside it, how many paintings, how many prints were inside it. And so after lunch, moving, you know, 2 or 3 hours ahead, Alex and I asked him, have you ever gone to the Bibliothèque Mazarin? It's the oldest public library in Paris. And I had never really heard about it until I read this piece of Michael Ondaatje's book, Warlight, about 2 summers ago. And they just mentioned it. And I was saying, what? I was thinking to myself, why haven't I been there? And so like any other tourist in town, I'm taking a person, of course, who lives in town who didn't know that the place existed. And so Alex and I walked, you know, calmly, not, we weren't in any rush, which was great. And we walked into this library and we could only go into the reading room. And I thought I know spirituality has been mentioned in the previous, you know, narratives that we've heard, but I thought I was going to faint. I mean, I love bookstores. I love libraries, which is one of the worst things of this pandemic. You can't go in and touch, you can't take the damn book off the shelf. You can't take the book off the shelf. You can't take it out of the library. You can't just stay in a table and just get absorbed by the whole element of being in a library. And going into this reading room, I wanted almost to sit down and have these incredible rare manuscripts and books. I mean, I was, can I say I was speechless? Because you couldn't say to all the French people or whoever that was in the chairs, it's like I'm exclaiming now. And Alex is looking at me walk very quietly because I'm mesmerized. And I'm still mesmerized by the thought because it's just one of the most gorgeous places on earth. And it's named after the cardinal who, it was his own personal collection in the 1650s. He had some connection, he lived during the time of Louis XIV, and it's in the Institute of France. It's right next to the Seine. It's enough by itself. Anyway, we walked out and I wanted to walk somewhere else in the Institute of France. And Alex had to tell me, Freddie, you cannot go in. The library was the only place that you could get into. I said, okay. Anyway, we walked up the block past Saint-Germain. And then he went into Benoit Forgiot's place and he wasn't there. And I told his assistant, I said, it's not like, you know, he was expecting me, but I knew where the bookshop was and I wanted to see these Vasilyev photographs. And so she called him up and she told him that I was there and that he would be there on Saturday afternoon. So then we would hook up and, we would hook up, but we didn't hook up that afternoon. And so I walked 3 bookshops later to this another rare bookstore that I had been in the morning. And I asked the guy who must have been from Central Casting. He had his tweed coat on. He might have been 240 years old. He had the thickest hair. He maybe was 75 or 80. I don't know. He couldn't have been that many years older than me, but he seemed ancient. And he was in the back, sitting at the table, just reading. Like, I looked at Alex. I said, does he know we're here? He didn't. I said, can I see the Soutine book? And he looks at me and he kind of nods. And he had these thick, tortoise shell glasses, so thick. I mean, they were magnifying glasses. Anyway, so I saw the Soutine book, and it was a 1991 or 1992 catalog by Taschen of the complete works of Soutine. So now I didn't have to buy, I thought, I don't have to buy Josh any more books of Soutine, because every print is here. And it is just colossal. It's in German, French, and English. Anyway, so I got it as a kind of a lifetime gift to my kid. And I carried it. I carried it out with so much happiness. And I made the guy laugh. I said something. He said, you're not going to find it in America. This price is really good. I said, think about it. A rare... Has anyone heard of Chaim Soutine? You want to raise hands? I mean, and this, he was good. Okay. He's kind of this rare bird who, you know, came from Vilna in Lithuania, and he was great friends of Modigliani, and he was just, you know, he was part of the scene in the 1920s and 1930s. And of course, because he was Jewish, he wasn't saved by the French. He had to get caught. He had a stomach ailment, and he died in 1943. In hiding in France. But so I got the book, I made this ancient guy laugh, and Alex is looking at me and he's thinking, you made two people laugh in two consecutive bookstores that one you didn't even know. And how did you do that? And I just said, well, I don't think about it. You just have this great kibitz, let's say, with the person in the store, because you love the store. These are fabulous stores. Anyway, so I got the book. We would meet again on the following Monday with another, you know, he did not take me to a ramen place. Not that he could have done that, but he took me to this great French place where, you know, it's when perhaps you were in college or when your parents would show up and you couldn't afford whatever the hell the restaurant was, and you knew the parents are gonna come in, so you take them to the best restaurant, you know, you haven't been able to afford. So he went to one of these great, you know, French restaurants and just had a great second time. But I felt an absolute intimacy with this guy. And not just because of what he didn't have, let's say, as a, you know, a father figure, because he had this great father figure. The father just wasn't there anymore. And I just felt like, I don't want to say this cliche of being family. I just felt so glad to know him through my kid. And we had this great, great two different afternoons of phenomenal experiences and conversation in a city that he knows I love, that a city that he lives in and loves, and he'll probably be, you know, a habitant, you know, for a long time. And so I just wanted to tell you this story of just spending this incredible afternoon with a 27 or 28 year old kid in Paris who showed me his Paris in a way that I would have never been able to see. Thanks.
That's beautiful.
Thank you.
Awesome.
Thank you, Freddie.
I think that's a really, really beautiful thing to talk about. This like kind of, also, hang on, first up, your romance with books is like deeper than any affair that I've ever had, except maybe with my husband, Andrew, he's lovely. But like, oh man, I want to talk to him like you talk about books.
Well, I just want to, you know, one kind of like a little piece afterward. On the Sunday, the day before I meet Alex the second time, I went to this place that had this fantastic, talk about something kind of spiritually connected. I went to a place called Diane de Sillier's bookshop, and mm-hmm. they publish one book a year. And I saw this book in the, because they also have the, you know, I mean, Paris should, they write the book on window shopping. They might have the best windows that I've ever seen. I said, yeah, I want to buy this and this and this. But they had a book called La Jeunesse de la Jeunesse. And it was, it's the beginning of the beginning. And it was a book written by a Parisian rabbi of the first 11 chapters of Genesis. They had it in, you know, they had it in printed Hebrew and in French on one side. And then they had, on the other side, they had some of the greatest abstract artists of the 20th century. Beautiful. So you're going through the first 11 chapters.
How many of that, how many of that chapter was begat, 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 begat?
Lots of abstract artists.
Send me your email and I'll be glad to tell you the count. Anyway, I got the book today, so.
50 yeah. pages of begat.
And it came to pass.
Right. Anyway.
Rothko, begat, begat.
Oh, Rothko, of course, is in there, yeah.
Anyway. Beautiful. Thank you, Freddie. Awesome. I feel like I was by the Seine with you there.
That was so great. It was nice to sort of be brought back to Paris in your story.
And to traveling and to being with like unexpected people and forging connections in places that you knew existed but perhaps hadn't fostered in a way that you expected. It's beautiful.
Yeah, thanks.
Yeah. Freddie.
That was so lovely.
Should we head on? Power on through?
I think we should.
Our fourth and final storyteller?
So before I read Raven's bio, which I will read in a second, I just want to say, I don't know if people know that there's this thing that happens every spring called the 24-Hour Project, where whoever, just random people all over the world, go out from midnight on Saturday morning until 11:59 that Saturday night, and they just take pictures on the street wherever it is that they live. And once an hour, they're posting photographs to Instagram. It's a way of sort of documenting the world for a day. And I've participated in it a bunch of times. And Raivenne, our next storyteller, has been my partner in crime for this crazy all night, all day, all night again, out on the street business. And thank God, because it's really hard to do by yourself. The first year I did it alone, and that was just hard. And having a partner is great, but having a partner like Raivenne, who is full of a lot of really great energy and humor and up for all sorts of nonsense, is the best kind of partner to have for some crazy, why are you up for 24 hours thing. So I just want to call you out and thank you publicly for that, Raivenne.
That's the only kind of partner you get for that. No one dull is signing up for that.
Yeah, I mean, you know, that's people true. Are just like, you're doing what? Just
like, oh, I don't.
24 hours?
For 24 hours? What? Yeah. So here's Raivenne's bio. Raivenne is a woman of contrasts. She's a very social person, but she also needs quiet time to herself. She thinks she leads a somewhat interesting life when she's not bored out of her mind. Some days that may mean running across the city in a stylized Santa suit, or shooting marshmallows at unsuspecting zombies. Some days it's the movies, Broadway, museums, opera, and or dinner with friends. Can you recall doing that? Some days then, most days now, it's a loaf of bread, a charcuterie plate, a bottle of Cabernet Sauvignon, and a good book. Mm. She is sarcastic, witty, and downright bawdy in her sense of humor. She likes learning new words and occasionally tossing out the odd archaic one. She cracks jokes and loves bad puns. Bad puns. No, seriously. If you did not audibly groan and or facepalm, then it was not a worthy bad pun. Sometimes she's the queen of civility. In others, she will make a sailor blush like a motherfucker. This is when I'm happy my mom has not dialed into our Zoom room. and sometimes she cusses her Rubenesque African-American Calipigian to the point of non-existence. You've been warned. And just putting it out there, she didn't get to be a big, beautiful woman by missing thirds. If you ever want to suck up to her, all you need to know is steak. Seafood is a this close second. Essentially, if it went moo or ba or came from underwater in a shell, she loves it. There are very few things she doesn't like. However, it would not be wise to surprise her with exotic fare such as balut, the Philippine street food of duck embryo, or something involving friendly neighborhood insect, even if it's Godiva chocolate covered, because you're probably not going to like her system's auto-purge response. Also, a good key lime pie works wonders, just saying. Everyone, Raivenne!
Yay!
Good evening, all.
Good evening
to some of you. People say that the most important memory mnemonic out there is usually a scent, that you can smell something, it can take you back in time, or you know, someone could pass by you eating McDonald's French fries, and all of a sudden you're remembering grandma's sweet potato pie from some picnic when you were 10. For me, I'm more of a sound person, so my total recall moment was based on a sound. It was late at night, my late husband was watching television, well, he was watching it, I was half falling asleep, you know, in that weird state where you kind of know you're falling asleep, but you're still kind of partially awake of the world. And I just heard this sound that all of a sudden reminded me of my mother. And we were in the apartment that we lived in when I was on Walton Avenue when I was 15. And I remember this so clearly. I remember that I was in jeans, white tube socks, a red and blue plaid shirt that had metallic threads through it. And I remember thinking I was feeling really cute because I had just gotten my hair done that day. And we all know when we were teenagers, when we know we looked good that day and you couldn't tell us a damn thing. It was one of those days. And I was preparing to go to the grocery store because my mother had wanted something from the store. I remember that she was wearing this pale blue cotton house coat. It looked like seersucker, but it wasn't. It just had blue and white stripes. It had a white yoke. It had all this little embroidery on the yoke of the dress. And I remember she had exactly four rollers in her hair, two on the side, one in the back. And there's one roller she kept here that created this sort of wave for her hair. Pink rollers. I just remember that. Before that. And she could have been a model when she was younger because she was just that pretty. Unfortunately, she married someone that had alternate ideas of what their life should be, AKA the man that sired me. So we'll leave that alone for a moment. But as I was getting ready to go to the store for her, my father came home, maybe about 5 or 10 minutes before this. And I remember that he was wearing black slacks, a tan turtleneck, black monk shoes. And his, at the time, because it was at this point, late 70s. Someone who still thought he was Shaft, but wasn't quite as cool or as honorable as the character, but he never quite gave up the ghost of that. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, he had came home drunk again, loud again, belligerent again, which was pretty much my teenage years. He had said something to my mother that I'm just not going to repeat. And then he walked past her to go to the bathroom. And I think he forgot that I was there because he passed by and he saw my door open. He looked in my room and we just kind of looked at each other and didn't say anything. When we made eye contact, he just seemed startled that I lived there for some strange reason. I rolled my eyes, I sighed, I just kept on putting on my shoes to get ready to go. Because he and I at that point had reached an understanding that we just don't talk to each other. Sometimes it's just that way. Don't talk to each other, it's the best relationship we could have had. But since he was drunk, I was wondering, do I still go to the store? Or do I need to wait until he falls asleep? Because while he and I had an understanding to not speak to each other, he and my mother had not quite gotten to that point yet. And as he passed my mother again, he had said something to her and she answered back and they started yelling at each other. And I had just put on my sneakers and I remember I was patting myself down to make sure I had my keys because I was still deciding whether or not I needed to leave or wait when I heard this sound that I know I shouldn't be hearing. And then right behind it, I'm saying this in reverse order. I heard one sound that I didn't want to hear. It was the sound of skin on skin contact. If you've ever actually heard someone's face being smacked in real life, you know that sound when you hear it. But it was the sound immediately after that that sent me running into their room. I get to the door of the room just in time to see my mother's hand stretched out to the side, that in motion of when you're swinging your hand out, and it was kind of frozen in a moment. And my mother and my father just kind of staring each other down. Mm-hmm. And I'm realizing what was, and then I realized what she had in her hand was a broken bottle of Pond's cold cream back in the day when Pond's cold cream came in glass. She had whatever, what he said to her, her response was to pick up that bottle, the empty bottle of Pond's cold cream, and smash him across the face with it. And then she just looked at him, went to the can, and dropped the what was left in her hand, which is the reason why I was going to the store, because she needed more cold cream. And the reason I remember that, because it was the sound of that glass breaking. It was the sound that triggered the memory some 20 years later, when I'm sitting, laying in bed, half going to sleep, and my late husband's watching TV, and something on the television had that sound. And whatever it was, that sound, it was that exact same sound as glass, as that Pond cold cream jar breaking across my father's face. And I just popped right back out of it. And then he's looking at me and I'm looking at him like, you don't want to know. But I did wind up telling him. But it was just weird that that one sound while I'm half asleep is what brought me back to that moment. But and to this day, certain times I hear glass and I think to myself, it's the sound of freedom. Because at that point, well, the understanding that my father and I had is that I had started fighting him back about a year before. So he realized he couldn't beat me anymore because I would fight him back and that was over. But he would still beat my mother. That was the first time in all of my years, at that point, 15 years, that she had fought back. And in my head, I thought that was the sound of freedom for both of us, because that was the last time he touched either one of us. So that was my total recall moment.
Yeah, that's huge. That's like, talk about, like, a number of people today have talked about, like, the moment of realizing that a memory is something different. Like, a moment of violence is a moment of, like, a moment of change in what you've just said. Like, it is a violent moment, but it is an incredibly liberating one in some ways. So, well,
yeah, it was.
Well, it's horrible and not a pleasant thing to go through. It's like this moment of great pride and forward motion. That's huge.
Yeah, no, it's amazing. And it's also interesting to me how many of the memories that we've heard about tonight are connected to sound. Like they're triggering these very powerful visceral memories. Just from hearing one small thing, and just like that sound that you heard when your husband was watching television, when you weren't really even watching it, it was just a sound over there, but it grabbed you instantly.
Yeah.
It's like, that's so amazing to me.
Raivenne, thank you. Yes.
Yeah.
Raivenne.
Wow.
Yay. What are you doing there, Freddie? Like some interpretive hand dancing?
I love
he's
it.
He's doing the Zoom dance, you know?
Bird flying.
Awesome. Yeah, how beautiful. How beautiful. Thank you all for sharing.
Thank you to all of our storytellers. Wow, yes. Shauna is sitting in the sunset, which is yes. Very lovely.
That looks like a terrible place to be, doesn't it?
The sunset is stupid, you guys.
You're so stupid.
Oh, wow.
Stupid. I've never seen anything more stupid.
That's fantastic. That's a perfect way to draw our evening to a close. I love it. Yeah. So next month, when we will also be on Zoom, even though it's probably true that the city will be starting to reopen, Christina and I decided that we would just stay on Zoom for June and figure out July when we get there.
Yeah. Once, if New York does open up next month, we still want to give it a couple of weeks because the space that we're in is very small, it's very tight.
There's no social distancing at open source. We're much too cozy.
No, we get real close. and also there's a lot of people who are being advised by folks, by the doctors, and just for their own sense of safety to stay put. So to make it accessible to lots of people, we want to keep it online. And yes, we'll see how July goes. At the moment, what is time? I don't know.
I know, right? We're all in the same day for the last 3 months.
Yeah.
But our theme for June is dismantle. All the things that maybe that puts into
breathe,
your
Amanda.
Head.
Breathe, Amanda.
No, Amanda, you got this. We can take it apart.
I'm so excited. I can't wait
I
to hear that.
How excited you are. That's so great.
Yeah. So
look, I am not heartbroken that you guys are forced to be online for this, because the only way I get to
participate. No, that's why you get to be here. It's so excellent.
I'm trying to figure out a way that we can, so we live stream the event when it's in person, but it's a bit different because you're just watching, but there's no way for everybody.
Yeah, we can't see and interact with you on the live stream.
But yeah, this has actually been a really beautiful experience. I got to have my family here from Australia.
Which is quite impressive. I can't get my family to log in from Maryland. So like I'm very excited that Christina's family
might actually help.
I will say that during this event, I got like an emergency text. I don't even know how to send an emergency text, but apparently my sister knows how. Because she wanted to make sure that I was not at the Barclays Center. I was like, when am I ever at the Barclays Center? Why are you texting me about this? Well, apparently
what's happening at the Barclays Center.
There was a protest that, of course, the police turned into a violent protest because they started beating the shit out of people.
It was a solidarity walk.
Yeah. So my family is very relieved that I said, but if you had listened to my invitation, you would know where I was. You'd be in the Zoom room with us right now, and you wouldn't have to be worried about me.
can we have one more round of Zoom applause for
Yay!
Amanda?
Thank you.
Yay!
Thank you.
For Freddie. Buddy! Raven, finally!
Raven!
Yes!
Wonderful, wonderful stories tonight, everyone. Thank you so much for being here. And thank you to everyone who's in our audience tonight.
Yes, everyone who came!
It's gotten so dark here, you can barely see us now. But Andrew,
I know.
I don't want to
here,
see just anyway.
You can see the glint of my eyes.
You can see it.
Nope!
Nope. I don't know. thank you for coming, everyone.
Thank you, everybody. Be well, stay safe, wear your masks, social distance, and we'll see you in June.
Thanks. You guys are awesome. I love you all.
We love you.
We love you, Amanda. We love all of you. Bye, everybody.
Bye.
Bye.